Is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So the last couple of sessions, we have been doing dynamic programming. Last two sessions, we have been doing dynamic programming, which is part of module 4. Just a quick recap of what we have done so far. Module 2 deals with two design techniques, divide and conquer and decrease and conquer. Under divide and conquer, we have seen five algorithms, merge sort, quick sort, binary search, max min, and Strassen's matrix multiplication. Although Strassen's matrix multiplication, we have not dealt in detail. The first four of them we have done along the analysis. In module 3, we have done greedy design. So under greedy design, we have come across algorithms like Prim's, Kruskal's, and Dijkstra's, all of them graph algorithms, fractional knapsack, job sequencing, and Huffman coding. Now, Prim, Kruskal, and Dijkstra's are based on generating minimal spanning tree, and a fractional knapsack, job sequencing, Huffman coding. All of them come under the category of optimization problems. This is what we have done in module 3. Module 4 deals with dynamic programming, in which two algorithms we have already seen, Warshall's algorithm and Floyd's algorithm. In module 3, we have done yet another design technique based on transform and conquer. And under transform and conquer, we have seen one algorithm, which is heap sort. Okay. Now, today's session will be based on the remaining part left out in module 2, which is decrease and conquer. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
The design technique which we will be seeing in module 2, which is the remaining portion left out in module 2, is decrease and conquer. There is one algorithm following decrease and conquer, and that is topological sorting. So this is a quick recap of what we have done so far. Decrease and conquer is a design technique which is very similar to divide and conquer. In a very simple way, if I would like to define it, decrease and conquer is a design technique which will try to solve a given problem by dividing it into sub-problems which are of the same type as the original one. So it can be well understood when you compare decrease and conquer with divide and conquer. What we have seen in divide and conquer is that when a problem is given to you, we keep dividing it into sub-problems, or in other words, you can say on every iteration or run of the algorithm, the given problem gets divided into sub-problems. Say on iteration 1, there are two sub-problems generated. We solve both the sub-problems. Then the next iteration, we keep dividing the problem into sub-problems, and each of the sub-problems is solved, and the solutions of these are combined together to generate the final solution. Whereas in decrease and conquer, on every run or iteration of the algorithm, the problem gets divided into sub-problems, but the number of instances of the sub-problems are not 2, but 1. As in, the problem size keeps reducing on every run of the algorithm. The best example that you can give for a decrease and conquer, which you have already come across in data structures, is a graph traversal algorithms. If you remember, we will be revisiting graph traversal in this session. We have already seen graph traversal algorithms like DFS, Depth First Traversal, and Breadth First Traversal. In both of these, to recollect what is traversal algorithm for a graph, given a graph having n vertices, the aim of any traversal algorithm would be to visit the vertices of the graph in a particular fashion. Now, DFS and BFS can be put under the design and conquer technique, as in, in the first iteration, when we traversing the graph, one vertex would fall into the visited category. In the next iteration, we go on to the next vertex. That would fall into the visited category. In the third iteration, the third vertex goes into the visited category. So, decrease and conquer is a design technique which tries to solve a given problem by reducing the problem size on every iteration. Very easily, you can call it as a single. The number of sub-problems that are generated at every iteration is only 1 in comparison to divide and conquer, where on every iteration, the number of subproblems generated is more than one. Okay. So just to briefly describe the three steps in the decrease and conquer, I'll just have a go through the slide now. Decrease and conquer technique is based on exploiting the relationship between a solution to a given instance of a problem and solution to its smaller instance. So the first step would be reduce problem instances to smaller instances of the same problem, solve the smaller instance, extend solution of smaller instance to obtain solution to the original instance. And conquer lies in the number of sub-problems that are created at every step of the solution. So this is something very important which you should be knowing. The difference between divide and conquer and decrease and conquer lies in the number of sub-problems that are created at every step of the solution. Decrease and conquer is a single sub-problem category in comparison to divide and conquer. So there are many variations of decrease and conquer. There are three main variations. I have highlighted it in the red. Decrease by a constant, decrease by a constant factor, and the third variation is variable size decrease. Now, these are the three different variations of decrease and conquer, which differ from one another by a very small difference between each of these design techniques. The first one, as the name indicates, decrease by a constant, reduces the problem size by a constant value on every iteration. This constant is usually one. I just now told you examples of, I've listed down the examples here. Insertion sort and graph traversals are the best examples you can give for a decrease by constant variation of decrease and conquer. As in, on every iteration of the algorithm or in every run of the algorithm, the problem size reduces by a constant value. And the constant is generally one. The constant size is generally one. In graph traversal, for example, if you see, when you start the algorithm, the number of vertices would be n, okay? Now, after one run of the algorithm, since one vertex would have been visited, in the next iteration, the number of vertices yet to be visited would be n minus 1. So, if you have reduced the problem size by 1. Now, in the subsequent iteration, one more vertex would go into the visited category. So, the problem size would now become n minus 2 and so on. Similarly, insertion sort. When you start the sorting, the problem size is n. After every run of the algorithm, the sorting, the length of the sorting or the number of elements which need to be sorted gets reduced by one. So this is called as the decrease by a constant variation. The second one is decrease by a constant factor. You know what is a factor? Problem instance is reduced by constant factor in every iteration. Now, a binary search is an algorithm which is generally debated, as in we have learned binary search under the divide and conquer design technique. But this is actually a debatable idea, as in binary search could also be told as an algorithm which falls into the decrease by constant factor, because on every run of the algorithm, the problem size reduces by half. So the constant factor here would be 1/2. Okay, that means the problem size or the reduction in problem size is half in every iteration. But if you see binary search, when the search, you're given a set of n numbers to be from which you're supposed to search a key value, the input gets reduced by half. Okay, you search the middle value, if the key in the middle value, if it is not the middle value, your search is focused either on the left half or on the right half. You ideally don't go to solve both the halves or search both the halves. Hence, binary search could also be put under the decrease and conquer category, because you're solving only one sub-problem. You're not solving both the sub-problems. So decrease by constant factor is a type of decrease and conquer design technique in which the problem size reduces by a constant factor on every iteration. Generally, the factor size doesn't go beyond 2. It's always 1/2. It's very rare when the constant factor size increases beyond half. The third variation is variable size decrease. As the name indicates, the problem size reduction in the problem size is in varying amounts on every iteration. The best example that you can give for the variable size decrease is Euclid's algorithm to find GCD of given two positive integers. We have learned it umpteen number of times, many number of times. when you're given two integers and solve it, finding GCD for those using Euclid's algorithm, the operation is you keep dividing m by n and keep assigning n to m and r to n till n becomes equal to zero, and you return m as a GCD. Now in Euclid's algorithm, the problem size reduces by varying amounts on every iteration. Large amounts it decreases, and this you put it under the variable size decrease. So decrease and conquer is a design technique in which a given problem is divided into a number of subproblems where the subproblems to be solved is of the same type as that of the original one. Ideally, the number of subproblems that you have to solve in every iteration is only one. That's why you put it under the single subproblem category. Okay. Now in this module, we are not going to see these three in detail. We will be only focusing on the first variation. The topological sorting is an algorithm which is based on the decrease by constant category. So this, we are going to focus on decrease by constant in detail. And generally, the constant value is always one. Okay, most often the constant value is one, which means n reduces to n minus one, then n minus two, n minus three, and so on, given the problem size is n. So in decrease by constant variation, the size of an instance is reduced by the same constant on each iteration of the algorithm. Typically, this constant is equal to one. So the most commonly dealt examples in a decrease by constant are insertion sort, graph traversals using DFS-BFS, and topological sorting. So what we would be doing in this module is the algorithm called topological sorting. Now this is a diagrammatic representation of decrease by one. You can also call it as decrease by one design category. The problem starts with size n. It gets divided into a subproblem of size n minus one. You can't say divided, it's getting reduced. Okay, the problem of size n is getting reduced to a subproblem of size n minus one. Then you find the solution to that subproblem, and solution, and this process is repeated till you find the solution to the original problem. Yes? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So we go on to the algorithm. Algorithm. Yes.
Janardhan, ma'am.
Sir.
Ma'am, if the students have any doubts, they can send through chat. Chat is enabled?
Yes, sir. I have not disabled the chat.
Okay. If they have any doubts, I'll try to address them.
Yes, sir. So you have heard, sir, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you have any doubts, you need not wait till the end of the session. Sir would help you. You can quickly post the doubts in the chat message. Sir will be answering the questions parallelly.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So this is a diagrammatic representation of a decrease by one design technique. Now we go on to the one major algorithm that is part of this module 2, which is based on specifically the decrease by one. Okay, decrease by one design. The topological ordering is not based on decrease by one design category. The algorithms which we are going to solve for this problem called topological ordering are based on design by one category, a decrease by one category. Now, before I discuss what is topological ordering, in order to explain topological ordering, I would just like to give you a very simple example which would highlight or very clearly explain what is the significance of topological ordering. I'll come back to this slide later. Now, assume that you are taking up a course called as postgraduate diploma in algorithms. Okay, and you're given a problem scenario wherein you're supposed to, the problem goes like this. You're asked to take up a course called as postgraduate diploma in algorithms. For taking up that course, there are a certain set of subjects which have to be taken up as mandatory subjects. Okay. Now, these subjects, what would be the best way if you're going to, what would be the best way to take up these courses in order to gain this postgraduate diploma so that each of the course, for example, you see this, I've modeled the complete scenario as a graph here. Assume that these are the subjects. C programming is a subject, data structures is a course, data structures lab is another course, DAA is another course. DAA lab is another course. A set of five courses are given to you. Okay. Now, these courses have to be ordered, linearly ordered in such a way that you can take up you can complete the course based on certain prerequisites. As in, you will be in a position to take up the course in DSA lab only if you have knowledge of C programming and data structures. Okay, so there is this is modeled as a graph wherein the nodes or the vertices represent the courses, and the edges represent the constraints. Constraints here refers to the prerequisites for taking up a course. For example, taking up DSA lab, you will have to take up C programming as well as data structures. So there is a directed arrow coming from C programming as well as data structures. Okay. Now, once you have the knowledge of C programming, data structures, and DSA lab, three of them, then you will be in a position to take up DAA, and then you will be in a position to take up DAA lab. Now, this problem scenario is represented as a directed acyclic graph. This is a graph, a directed graph without any cycles. Okay. Now, given this example, now I would like to define what is topological ordering. Topological ordering, or you call it as topological sorting, is a linear ordering of the vertices of a directed acyclic graph, in which if you take any vertex, I'll go back to the previous slide, topological ordering of a directed graph, please note it is a directed acyclic graph, is a linear ordering of the vertices of the DAG such that for every directed edge UV from vertex U to vertex V, U comes before V in the ordering. For example, if you take any edge, C programming DSA lab, then in the linear ordering, C programming should appear before DSA lab. If I'm going to order the vertices linearly and call it as a topological ordering of this given graph, then for every directed edge UV, assume U as C programming, V as DSA lab, then in the linear ordering, C programming should appear before DSA lab. I call it as topological ordering. And this, I call it as topological ordering when a problem scenario is given to you where there are certain constraints imposed on the problem. The constraints here are that to take up a particular course, you should have already satisfied some prerequisites. For taking up DAA and DAA lab, you should be having the knowledge of all these three courses. Okay, so this is what I call it as topological ordering. Just to redefine it, it is, remember, the graph in a topological ordering problem has to be a directed acyclic graph, because you're going to generate a linear ordering, you cannot have cycles in the graph. So given a directed acyclic graph, topological ordering of the graph for any edge UV, from vertex U to V, U always comes before V in the ordering. When we see an example, this will be more clear to you. For instance, the vertices of the graph, explain what I discussed just now, the vertices of the graph may represent tasks to be performed in a general scenario. And the edges may represent constraints that one task must be performed before another. So in this case, what are the vertices representing? The vertices are representing the courses. And what are the edges representing? The edges represent the prerequisites or the constraints that has to be satisfied if the course has to be taken up. So for instance, the vertices of the graph may represent tasks to be performed, and the edges may represent constraints that one task must be performed before another. In this application, the topological ordering is just a valid sequence for the tasks. So you're going to generate a valid sequence or a linear ordering of the tasks. A topological ordering is possible if and only if the graph has no directed cycles. That is, if it is a DAG. Any DAG has at least one topological ordering. There can be any number of topological orderings for a given graph. The only condition is that if you take any directed edge UV, U always has to appear before V in the linear ordering or in the topological ordering. So I've just listed down some examples here. Course ordering is one of the best examples that you give for topological ordering. Then scheduling. job scheduling or job sequencing is one example. Assembly lines in industries is another example. Food chain, you give it as a very common example of topological ordering. Now we are going to see how we solve topological ordering. What are the algorithms that will be used in this module to solve topological ordering? Or it is otherwise called as topological sorting. There are two algorithms that we are going to see. One is called as a source removal algorithm. The second one is we are going to generate topological ordering using depth first search. You are all aware of depth first search. We will be just revisiting depth first search before we see how we can use depth first search to generate a topological order. So there are two algorithms, source removal algorithm, and the second one is depth first search. So both of these fall under the design category decrease by constant. Decrease by constant, where the constant size is equal to 1. That means on every iteration, the problem size reduces by 1. Now we go with the first algorithm, the source removal algorithm, topological ordering using the source removal algorithm. The algorithm is very simple, in fact. Here I've given a diagrammatic representation of how the algorithm works. In the next example, I will just show you how step by step it is actually done. It's very simple. While the graph is non-empty, the algorithm goes like this. While the graph is non-empty, remember the graph has to be a DAG, directed acyclic graph. Identify a vertex with no incoming edges. So you have given the graph, the first step is to identify a vertex with no incoming edges. So you such a node, you call it as a source node. Okay. So given this graph here, in this graph, there are two such nodes, node C1 and node C2. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah, so if you consider this DAG, there are two nodes here with no incoming edges. So either C1 or C2, both of them I can call them as source nodes. Okay. Identify a vertex with no incoming edges. Add the vertex to a list. Remove that vertex and all the outgoing edges from it. So here in this problem scenario or in this instance of the graph, I'm just identifying that C1 is a node without any incoming edges. Remember, you can also start with C2, but as in this example, I'm starting the topological ordering from the node C1. I identified C1 as a source node. What is a source node? A node which does not have any incoming edges. So after identifying a source node, remove that node along with all its outgoing edges. So it is written over here as delete C1. Once this node is deleted along with its outgoing edges, this is the resultant graph. So this is the first run of the algorithm in which you have deleted one node along with its outgoing edges. So the problem initially had, or the graph initially had 5 vertices. We have now reduced the problem size by 1. And now the number of vertices here are 4. The algorithm repeats. Identify the source vertex again. Remember, this C1 we have added into the topological ordering as the first vertex. Okay, that means C1 is the first vertex in the topological ordering. Now this is the resultant graph after the first run of the algorithm. We identify the source vertex once again. Now C2 is the next source vertex which I identify, obviously. I remove C2 along with its outgoing edges. So once C2 is removed, this is the resultant graph. We have once again reduced the problem size by 1, decreased by 1. Now the number of vertices are 3 in number. Identify we have added C1, then C2, okay, into the topological ordering. Now this is the resultant graph. In this graph, identify the source node. C3 is a source node because it does not have any incoming edges. Since C3 is identified as a source node, I will remove C3 along with its outgoing edges. So C3 is removed with its outgoing edges. The problem size is now 2. Once again, the problem repeats. The algorithm repeats. With C4 as a source node, it does not have any incoming edges. We remove C4 and the remaining last vertex which is available is only C5. We remove C5. So the topological ordering using, this is called as a source removal algorithm. because in every run of the algorithm, we identify the source node and remove it. A source node is one such node which does not have any incoming edges. You can start this for this problem instance. You could have very well started with source node as C2. A given directed acyclic graph can have any number of topological orderings. All of them are valid. You can have any number of topological orderings for a given DAG. Okay. So here we have the ordering would be C1, C2, C3, C4, C5. So we go, have a look at another example. Are you all there with me? Can I continue?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is another example given a DAG here, a directed acyclic graph. So which would be the source node here?
B.
B would be the source node. So I'll just go and show you how this works. So identify B as a source node. B is removed. B is removed. The problem size is reduced. And now the problem size is 4. Identify the next source node.
A. Yeah,
next source node. A is removed and added into the linear ordering. Next source node would be D. So we identify D and remove D. The next source node would be C. Identify C. Source node would be E. Identify it and remove it. B, A, D, C, E is the topological ordering of the given graph. Using which algorithm? The algorithm that we have used is called as a source removal algorithm. Okay, so we have just seen what is topological ordering, what is designed by decreased by one design technique, and how the source removal algorithm works to generate the topological ordering of a given tag. The steps in the algorithm would be, first you identify the source node, remove the source node, and then add it as the first vertex in the linear ordering. Then repeat the algorithm, repeat these steps for the remaining nodes. Okay. Now we go to the next algorithm called the DFS algorithm. You're all aware what is the DFS algorithm. You've already learned it in data structures. How can we use the DFS algorithm to generate the topological ordering is the next topic. Or is a topic of the discussion next. The algorithm steps are as follows. Run DFS of the given DAG, first step. Record the, just to recap or revisit the DFS algorithm, a depth first search traversal algorithm is a traversal algorithm for a graph. A traversal algorithm, you know what is a traversal algorithm. For assuming an input graph, a G with V vertices and E edges, the aim of any traversal algorithm would be to visit all the vertices of the given graph in a particular order with assuming any one of the vertices as a starting vertex. There are two ways in which you can traverse a graph, either depth-first traversal or a breadth-first traversal. With depth-first traversal, the traversal proceeds in a depth-first manner, starting with any vertex, which means it visits one vertex, then it goes on to visit the neighboring vertices of the already visited vertex, and this continues. This process of visiting the vertices continues till we visit, till we reach a node which becomes a dead end.
Exam.
I can hear the background. Please mute yourself. The aim of depth first traversal algorithm is to starting with any vertex. The aim of depth first traversal algorithm is to traverse a given graph starting with any vertex and keep visiting the neighboring vertices of the currently visited vertex till we reach a vertex which becomes a dead end. What is a dead end node or a dead end vertex in a during traversal of a graph? Any such node which does not have any unvisited neighbors, we call it as a dead end. Once a dead end is reached, we keep backtracking till we reach a node which has still got nodes to be visited. Now we will see an example. I don't think it would be of any use to keep explaining it in words like this. I will just show you an example, revisit DFS, and then show you how DFS can be used for the topological ordering. Okay, so just go through the steps. Step one, run DFS on the given tag. Step two would be record the pop order or exit order of the vertices in the stack trace. If you remember, in order to visualize or conceptualize depth first traversal, we have always used a stack. And in order to understand DFS, we used a which data structure? The queue data structure. Okay. So the stack trace would be helpful to record the push order and the pop order of the DFS traversal. Whenever a node is visited, it is pushed onto the stack. Whenever a node becomes a dead end, it is popped from the stack. So in topological ordering, the pop order of the DFS traversal is used in generating the topological ordering. Step two would be to record the pop order of the vertices in the stack trace. Step three would be reverse the pop order to give the topological ordering of the given graph. So I will revisit this algorithm once again once we see an example. Assume that this is a graph given to you. We have already seen this graph. We have run the same graph with the source removal algorithm. Now we are going to do, the aim is the same, generate topological ordering of the given tag. But the algorithm that we are going to use now is the depth first search traversal algorithm. We can start with any vertex. We can start with any vertex as a source vertex in the traversal algorithm. Here I would start with A. Okay. So in order to show how the DFS traversal works, we will be using a stack to show the traversal order. Whenever a node is visited, the node will get pushed onto the stack. And when a node becomes a dead end, we have to backtrack. So when the node becomes a dead end, it is popped from the stack. Okay. I would first be showing you a simple stack trace here, and then I will show you an Excel sheet in which we will be recording the push order as well as the pop order. Please listen carefully here. So the first step, I start with A as the source vertex from which I start the traversal. As per the DFS traversal algorithm, the first step is to go to the neighbors of A. The neighbors of A are C and D. The neighbors of A are C and D. I'm first going to visit C. So once A is visited, it is pushed onto the stack. Assume that this is a stack ordered bottom up. Okay, bottom up. So I would be stacking the next vertex on top of A. Okay, so are you all there with me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so A is the first vertex that we have visited. From A, we go to the neighboring vertices of A, one of the neighboring vertices of A, which is yet to be visited. The neighboring vertices of A are C and D. We are going to C. Okay, so we have visited C. We visited C, hence C is stacked on top of A. C is the next node to be pushed onto the stack. Once C is over or C is visited, remember, once a node is visited, this DFS is also falls under the category decrease by one. So once A is visited, the remaining unvisited vertices are four in number. So five, the problem size of five has got reduced by one. Now the remaining vertices would be four. Once C is visited, C is pushed onto the stack. We go to the neighboring vertices of C. The neighboring vertices of C is only one, which is E. Okay. So since E is the only neighboring vertex, we visit E. E is pushed onto the stack. Now, can we go from E?
No, ma'am.
We cannot go from E. So I call E as a dead end.
Dead end.
Now, during the DFS traversal, any such node is a dead end node, which does not have any unvisited neighbors. E does not have any unvisited neighbors, so E is a dead end. Once we reach a dead end node during traversal, the next step would be to backtrack. Okay.
Yeah.
So we have to backtrack from E to C. So when we backtrack, we pop E. We pop E, then backtrack, and we reach C. Okay. Once we reach C, is C a dead end?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
C is a dead end because it does not have any unvisited neighbors. So which means we from E, E is a dead end, we backtrack to C. C is a dead end. Now we have to backtrack from C to A, which means from the stack, we have to pop E as well as C. We have popped E first. Please keep in mind the pop order. We have popped E first, then we have popped C. Now the pop order is going to play a role here because in topological ordering, we are not interested in the visit order or the push order. We are actually interested in the pop order because we are going to use the pop order in order to generate the topological ordering. So we have popped E, we have popped C, we have reached A. Now, can I call A as a dead end node?
No, ma'am.
I cannot call A as a dead end because A has still got unvisited neighbors. So next step would be to visit D.
D.
So once D is visited, it is pushed onto the stack. Now, D is a dead end because D, all its neighboring nodes or neighboring vertices are all visited. So we backtrack from D to A. Now when I backtrack from D to A, can I call A as a dead end? Yes. Yes, I can call A as a dead end because A does not have any unvisited neighbors. So we would pop D and then we would pop A. Okay. Now the next step would be, is the DFS still continues and finds out if there is any unvisited node? Yes, there is an unvisited node, which is B. So B is pushed onto the stack and then B does not have any unvisited neighbors and hence B is also popped. Okay. So in what order did we pop the vertices? We popped E, then we popped C, then D, then A, and then B. Okay. We popped E, then we popped C, then we popped D, then A, then B. First, record the pop order, then reverse the pop order to generate the topological ordering. So your topological ordering would be B, A, D, C, E. Okay. Now, when we gave the definition at the beginning of topological ordering, how did we define it as? If you take any directed edge A, C, then A has to appear before C in the linear ordering. Now, note the topological ordering. A appears before C. Please don't assume that A and C should appear adjacent to each other in the topological ordering.
Okay.
It wouldn't appear like that. If you take the edge DE, D always appears before E. D has to appear before E. You take an edge DC, D appears before C. Don't assume that it has to be adjacent to each other. That's not what is topological ordering. You take any directed edge in the graph, that direct for any directed edge UV, U has to appear before V in the topological ordering. Now I'll just revisit that algorithm. Yeah, this algorithm, run DFS on the given tag. Record the pop order or the exit order of vertices in the stack trace. Reverse the pop order to give the topological ordering of the given graph. Okay. Now I will just show you an example. Now the same thing, whatever we have done now, from the examination point of view, I would just discuss another way of representing the same stack trace. Please give me a second. Can you see the Excel sheet here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now the same graph which we did. This is a graph which we've already done. This is a new graph which I have taken. Now the from your textbook point of view, okay, or from your examination point of view, this is another way of representing the DFS traversal. Okay. The concept remains the same. There is no confusion. The concept is the same. But we would just be showing you how we record the push order and pop order. Okay. Now we know that we start with A. Okay. So assuming that this is a stack, For every stack entry, I'll give a label. Please listen carefully. For every stack entry, I would give a label. Each label, can you see this or is this too tiny?
No, ma'am, we can see.
Yeah. So for every stack entry, there would be a label. That label would have two values. The first one would be the push order, and the second one would be the pop order. For example, A is the first node to be visited. So I would just mention it as one. That means A is the first node to be visited. Did you get it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now from A, we visited C. So C would be the second node to be pushed. So what does this one and two represent? One represents the push order of A. Two represents the push order of C. Okay. Then the next node to be visited was E. So I write three here. That means A got visited once, the first, then C got visited, then E got visited. So this one, two, three in the label for every stack entry denotes the push order or the order in which these vertices got pushed into the stack. Now, is E a dead end? Yes. Since E is a dead end, the next step would be to pop E as per the traversal algorithm. So I would write comma one. What is the meaning of this? The meaning of, are you all there with me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Bus dead end.
Yeah, yeah. Now, the meaning of this is the one in the second entry in the label denotes that E is the first node to be popped. And what does three represent? E is the third node to be pushed. And E is the first node to be popped. So in the label, three represents the push order and one represents the pop order. Okay. So once we popped E, what is the next node that we reach when we backtrack? We reach C.
C.
Is C a dead end? Yes. C is a dead end. So what I would do, I would pop C. So C is which node to be popped? Second node to be popped. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
All of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, a second node to be popped. Then we reach
B.
Then we reach A. Is A a dead end? No. A is not a dead end. So D, next we visit D from A. So D would be which node to be pushed onto the stack?
Fourth
node. So I would write a four here. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now is D a dead end? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
D is definitely a dead end. So it is a which node to be popped?
Third
node. So comma three. Okay. So D is popped. So I have shown D here in the second column here. Because assuming that C and E are all popped, I'm stacking D on top of A. Okay, I've shown the second column like that. Okay, so D is a third node to be popped. Once D is popped, we reach A. Is A a dead end? Yes. So A would be the fourth node to be popped.
Popped.
Once A is also popped, the only node that is available to be visited is B, which is the fifth node to be pushed onto the stack. Now, B is a dead end, so we pop B. Okay, so now I write down the pop order. What is the pop order? Write down the pop order. E,
C,
D,
A, and B. I'll reverse the pop order, so that will be B, A,
D,
C, E. Did you get it?
Yes, ma'am.
This is one other representation of the same DFS traversal algorithm. This is exactly the representation that you would find in your textbook Leviton for DFS. Okay? For DFS and subsequently for topological ordering. So you have to, the topological ordering using DFS records the pop order and then it reverses the pop order to generate the topological ordering. So this would be the topological ordering for this given graph. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Now we will just see another example very quickly here. So remember, you can start with any vertex and you can visit the graph in any order. There may be multiple topological orderings for a given graph. One point to be noted. The second point to be noted the ordering generated by the source removal algorithm and the DFS algorithm would be different, but they are not wrong. The topological ordering generated using source removal may be different from the ordering generated using DFS. They may not be wrong. They are not wrong. Okay. So here we start with the, so when there are multiple vertices or multiple starting vertices, generally it is a good practice to start in alphabetical order or numerical order.
Numerical order.
Yeah, that would be better. Although there is no hard and fast rule like that, that would be better. Okay. Yeah, so I'm again showing you the stack trace of the topological ordering using DFS. So I start with zero, okay? So we started with zero, zero Z, I'll just write down here, zero Z, first. I hope you're clear with the label here.
Yes, ma'am.
This label, every stack entry is defined by a label. There are two values in the label. The first value represents the push order and the second value represents the pop order for that respective entry. Okay, now we go on with this graph. So the zero is the first vertex. From zero, we would go to two. Two is the next vertex to be visited. Okay, so here I will write down two. Okay, two. Then from two, the next vertex in sequence would be three. So three is visited. So I would write down three, push order. Then from three, I would visit
six.
So this would be the fourth node to be visited. Okay, one, two, three, four in order. Then that is zero, two, three, and six. Is six a dead end?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So I would pop six. When I pop six, I would reach three. Is three a dead end?
Yes.
Yes. So I would pop three. Second node to be popped. Then we reach two. Is two a dead end?
No.
No. So we push which node? Next.
Four.
We push four. So four would be which node to be pushed? It is the fifth node to be pushed. Are you clear?
Yes, ma'am.
All of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so 4 is the fifth node to be pushed. Yes, from 4, we would visit. From 4, we would visit 7. So 7 will be the sixth node. Yes. Then, is 7 a dead end?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So I would pop 7.
4 again.
Third.
No.
4.
I have three to push 7, right?
Yeah.
Sorry, pop 7.
That is 3, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so, correct. So it will be the which node to be popped? It will be the third node to be popped. Yeah. Third node to be popped. Once I reach pop 7, I would reach 4. So is 4 a dead end? Yes.
Yes.
That will be the fourth node to be popped. So 1, 2, 3, 4 nodes are popped. Once I pop 4, I would reach 2. Okay? Yes? Okay.
Yes,
now 2 is not a dead end.
Yes.
So we started with 0. We visited 2, then we visited 3, then we visited 6. 6 is a dead end, so we backtrack to 3. 3 is a dead end, so we backtrack to 2. From 2 is not a dead end, so we visited 4. From 4, we visited 7. 7 is a dead end, so we backtrack to 4. 4 is a dead end, so we backtrack to 2. 2 is not a dead end, so we visited 5. So we will visit 5 now. So it is which node to be pushed now?
7th.
7th node. Okay, now 5 happens to be a?
Dead end.
Dead end. 7 is a dead end node.
Dead
so
end.
I will write it as which node to be popped? 5th node.
Yeah.
5th node to be popped. So 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. This is 1 here popped. 2 popped. 3. Third node to be popped is 7. Fourth node to be popped is 4 and the fifth node to be popped is 5. Once we pop 5, we reach 2 again. We reach 2 again. Okay. Now 2 is a
dead end.
So this will be comma 6. Okay. Once we pop 2, we reach 0. 0 also happens to be a dead end. So we pop 0 also. Now the only node that is left unvisited is 1. So that would be the eighth node to be pushed as well as popped.
Eighth, yeah.
To be popped. So now I'll record the pop order. What is the pop order? Please record the pop order. Pop order would be 6, 3, 7, 4, 5, 2, 0, and then 1. Okay, I will reverse the pop order. So that would be 1, 0, 2, 5, 4, 7, 3, and 6. Okay, so this is your topological ordering. So I guess I have done with today's session. So if you have any doubts, you can continue. So I just summarize what we have done today. We started with decrease and conquer design technique in module 2. Module 2 deals with two design techniques, divide and conquer and decrease and conquer. Decrease and conquer is a design technique which finds solution to given problem by reducing the problem size on every iteration. The amount by which the problem size reduces can be of different types, or the problem size reduction can be of different types, based on which there are three categories: decrease by a constant, decrease by a constant factor, variable size decrease. In this module, we will be focusing only on the first variant, which is decrease by constant. Decrease by constant is a type of decrease and conquer design strategy in which on every run or iteration of the algorithm, the problem size reduces by a constant value. And this constant value is 1. Most often 1. So instead of calling it as decrease by a constant, we would also call it as decrease by 1. The problem that we discussed in this module, I will open the slide once again. The problem that we discussed in this module is topological ordering. Topological ordering, or otherwise it is called as topological sorting, is a linear ordering of the vertices of the given DAG in such a way that for any directed edge UV, the vertex U should always appear before the vertex V. To solve topological ordering, we have considered two algorithms. One is called a source removal algorithm. The second one is using DFS. Both of these algorithms are based on decrease by one design strategy. The source removal algorithm is an algorithm wherein the first step would be to identify the source node. The source node is any node which does not have any incoming edges. Identify the source node, remove the source node along with all its outgoing edges. And the order in which the nodes are removed would be the linear ordering of the, or the topological ordering of the given graph. The second algorithm with which we saw topological ordering is a DFS algorithm. In DFS algorithm, the aim is to visit the graph using DFS algorithm, and while doing so, record the pop order, reverse the pop order to generate the topological ordering. We have seen two examples. We've also seen how we can do this or record these stack trays using a very easy representation by giving it every stack entry a label, in which each label would have a push order as well as the pop order. So we come to the end of this session, and by this we finish module 2 in entirety. Okay, we have finished divide and conquer as well as decrease and conquer. Module 1 is done, module 2 is done, module 3 is also done. The next sessions will be continued with dynamic programming in module 4. Thank you. Any doubts? You're open to doubts.
No, ma'am.
Students, any doubts?
No, sir.
Sir, have they asked you any doubts? Were they there?
Yes, ma'am. Few of them had messaged me. I have clarified their doubts.
Okay. So, can end the meeting, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, students.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.